House, Lord. We're going to praise you through every storm. Every bad day, it doesn't matter. We're going to praise you through it, Lord.
The world,
come on,
but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough.
No, they're not, Lord.
And you came along and put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh. To show you my weakness, my failures and flaws, Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. As the God of the mountain, the God of the valley, there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Truth, Lord.
On into dancing, you give beauty for ashes, you turn shame into glory, you're the only one. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. You turn morning to dance. You turn bones into wine.
Without you, Lord, we would be nothing. You do it all. You're worthy of it all. We could search everywhere and not find anything better than you, like we just sang about.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet.
And you never will, Lord. You'll never fail.
I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again.
Jesus.
Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail.
Do everything in my life, Lord, and I know that others feel the same. Let's get ready to really dig in and praise Him. He's gonna do it again.
Never. and I never will forget.
We serve a God tonight with that reputation. Do you know? Yes. And we sing about that too. Do you know our God? He's not messed up and he's not lost. I love his promise. I feel like if we could get just that one line of that one chorus and hold on to that. Do you know what? I want you to think about this. Think about all that you've been through. Think about everything that's happened in your life. And listen to this. This is the truth. This is the word of God. His promise still stands.
Yes, it does.
Great is his faithfulness.
No matter what, his promise still stands.
His promise. His promise is the one that holds up. His promise is the one that doesn't weaken. His promise is the one that doesn't say, hey, I'm going to do it now and I'm not going to do it for you. His promise still stands. Anybody, can somebody just give the Lord praise if you found that the Lord in his faithfulness are able to be trusted? Do you trust that God's faithful tonight? He's an awesome God. He is an awesome God. And I was thinking about this. I gotta borrow this set of lyrics for a second. That first song, we got to singing this, and I felt like my spirit wanted to just leap out of my body, because I want you to think about what no other source, what no one else can do, but we're here tonight because the one who can take a grave and turn it into a garden is here. The one who can take what is dead and what is dismissed and what is over and can turn it into a place of growth, can turn it into a place of harvest, can turn it into a place of just being revitalized. He's the one that's here. The one that does that. Graves into gardens. What else was it? See, this, I was looking through this and, oh my goodness. Bones into armies.
Mourning into dancing.
Listen, I'm just, you know what? I'm kind of sick of Christians walking around with faces that look like you're walking in mourning all the time. You know what? We're not defeated. Jesus is alive. The King is coming. He's not coming back as a little baby being cradled. He's coming back as a victorious, conquering King. Can somebody that's been mourning, somebody that's been just sitting still, somebody that's just been, I don't know what's wrong, I'm just doing it. Can somebody turn a little bit of your mourning into praise and dancing tonight? Can we do it? Come on. I see Justin's ready. Come on, mourning into praise. Mourning into blessing the Lord. Mourning into dancing. See, he's the one that's here. He takes bones, turns them into armies. He turns seas. I just want you to think about this. What is it that's in your way? What is it that seems like a wall? What is it that's the problem that torments you the most? Well, my God, our Savior, can turn the sea that's in front of you into a highway. The thing that you think is going to stop you can be what just projects you straight on down the boulevard, right onto where you need to be. Accelerate us right through it. I'm so excited tonight. Can we just bless the Lord just a little bit more? Can we honor him?
Hallelujah.
God is so good. He is such an awesome God. And he is working. I've had people this week tell me, I just got to tell you, Pastor Jason, God has been so good to me. He is doing this in my life. He is doing that in my life. He is restoring this. He's bringing this. He's answering this prayer. God is so good. I want to tell you, you are in a great place tonight. Location, but not just location. If you're here tonight, you are in a great place, because where the Spirit of the Lord is,
there is freedom.
Anybody glad to be free tonight?
Yes.
I'm glad to be free. I'm so glad. I'm so excited to be free in the Lord tonight. And I want to say something. I also, this week, I've had a couple people telling me, along with just testimonies of God answered this prayer and that prayer, I've had about four different folks tell me, hey, I just want to tell you again, do you know how faithful God is? Do you know how faithful God is? And I've had a couple back to back to back financial miracles, basically. And I was looking at this, and sometimes we forget, but I was looking at this before service ever started. And do you know, right here, just in case you're ever confused, right on the back of these contribution envelopes, I purposely printed something so that you could look at it and hear the promises of the Word of God concerning your finances. He's got some promises. And I was looking at this. Do you know that it's in Job, it's in Psalms, it's in Proverbs. As the righteousness of God, I declare that I am favorable in God's sight. Do you know when you come to Jesus Christ, you become favored in God's sight?
Absolutely.
All that you do, all that you put your hands to, everything that you work toward, all that you invest your life, your talents, abilities, and finances in. When you say yes to Him, do you know you can expect favor in your life? The next one, I'm looking at number two. I kind of tease on this because people like to say this a lot, but this is just fact. New Testament, book of Luke, I'm blessed.
Yes.
And highly favored.
Yes.
How many of you want to be blessed and highly favored and want to live in that and walk in that? I know I do. And God's been so faithful. I've been preparing for things in this wilderness series that is going to be probably going on for a few weeks. And I am so blessed. God has favored me and my family and my home and our future, our past, our health, our finances so much. And it's not even anything we deserve. It's because we said yes to Him. And I want to challenge you in the house or watching tonight, say yes to Jesus every time. Say yes to Him and watch His highly favored show up in your life. He does it. Does He not, Miss Smith, sitting right there, and Miss Smith right behind her, and Miss Yaroshevsky behind them, and Mr. Kelly, and other Miss Yaroshevsky, and Mr. I mean, just going back through. Has God favored anybody? Has He proven Himself and shown Himself? I'm so thankful. And now this one, in Genesis, it says, I associate with those who are blessed and highly favored, so that I may increase in every area of my life. You know, God will even give us wisdom, the people to spend our time, influence, investment, finances with. You know, I've been around people in my life that consumed everything that I had. They took everything I had, all of our time, all of our money, all of our focus. And then there's people you can get around that they say, wait a second, God is good. Let's serve Him together. And I'm excited. Honestly, I wanted to read and share this because I'm excited because you know what? We really are a family. We're really a church and a ministry that I believe with all my heart is about the Father's business.
Yes.
Don't mistake about the Father's business for easy. Don't mistake about the Father's business for convenient. And don't mistake about the Father's business for perfect. But just know, when you're about His business, He'll bring you through it. Just like we found out our wilderness. Sometimes our driest times and the roughest spots are the ones that are the most sacred opportunities to get close to Him. And I want to challenge you. I wanted to say this because God wants some folks free financially as well. The burdens that we have on our minds and in our hearts, the Word of God also promises freedom. Promises the same favor that we'll stand and rejoice and clap about. God promises that same freedom, protection, and favor financially. And I want you to know, when we give, when we worship and honor the Lord in our giving, it's just one more way to say, Lord, I do trust You in every area of my life. I look down at the next one. I operate in integrity. According to Proverbs 11:27, I operate in integrity, and as a result, I obtain favor from God. See, that one has, like, I do this, therefore I receive this. It's time for the church to be a church of integrity. It might sound like an elementary lesson, but we need to stop lying. We need to stop sinning. We need to stop cheating. We need to stop being angry. We need to stop hurting people. Operate in integrity. Operate in integrity. And therefore receive the blessings of God and His highly favored desires to pour on you. And I looked further in Esther 2 and Psalm 75. I can declare that God's favor promises and promotes and causes me to increase daily. God's promise. We rejoiced and praised God because we said, Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. And we just sang that. Do you know his word promises that he'll increase you daily if you continue to stand on him? There's only just a few more. The Lord, this might be one of my favorite ones, because how many of you want God to be pleased? Do you want God to be pleased with you? Do you want him to be pleased with your choices, your decisions, your life? I do. I don't want him to look at me with an eye and a heart of judgment against me. I want him to look and celebrate what I'm doing, the choices I'm making. The word says here in Psalm 36, the Lord takes pleasure in our total life prosperity. Do you know it makes him happy and it gives God pleasure to see you prosper in every area of your life? He doesn't want to see you down, not in one spot, not one little area, not one corner. Because I am God's favorite, according to 3 John, now this is a good one. And I want you to know, this is printed on here. Every time you sow any seed in here, this is promises that we're declaring, that we're promoting and believing, and seeds sown. God, all of your promises, it says, because I am God's favorite, I prosper in every area of my life, spiritually, physically, financially, socially, and mentally. 3 John chapter 2. And the last one I want to share, it comes out of Deuteronomy 8 and also repeated in Psalm 112. Wealth and riches are in my house because I'm empowered with his anointing and favor to draw wealth. That's some great promises. Do you want those promises to be yours? I'm just curious. Churches get excited about being free, but then if God says be free in every area, some people want to say, well, I want to be free only in a couple spots, Lord. God says, I've made a way. I died on the cross so you'd be free in all areas of your life. He wants you free in all areas of your life. Psalm told us that he takes pleasure in that. Tonight, as we worship and giving, I want you to consider this. What is it that's more important to God? Or what is it that's more important to you? Is it God and obeying his word and worshiping and living for him tonight? I'm seeing all sorts of conversations out at the Union Grove. Wait, is that what it's called? Union Grove? Yeah. Union Grove, Fire in the Grove. I'm seeing other churches and pastors talking about this. And a lot of people are throwing around the terminology like Fire in the Grove, this revival fire. Other pastors, revival this and revival that. Here, we've used it. We sing God of Revival. What do you think that it's going to take to bring a powerful, fire-filled, everlasting, non-stop revival in us? What do you think that will be? Prayer and fasting? A hunger for God? Loving God and loving people, obedience. Actually, every one of those is very vital. I want us being doers of the word, taking action. I want us to remember this. It will not be enough for us just to come and be encouraged and high five and slap each other on the back. It's great to make friends, but do you know what we're called to do? Go and tell. Jesus is coming back. He's coming back. What are we waiting for? We want to talk about revival and God do it again and graves into gardens and singing all kinds of things about God, and it's powerful and it's real. But tonight I feel just this pushing and urging to say, let's do something about what we sing. Let's do something about what we declare. Let's do something about the word that's declared and preached. Don't get bored with that. Because I can guarantee you, if Jesus stood right here in front of the church tonight, and he could tell you, I guarantee he would say, I need you to be my voice. I need you to be my hands extended. I need you to go tell someone about what I did. There's a whole world that doesn't even know I've already paid the price for them to be adopted into the family. They don't even know that we love them. They don't even know there's a place for them. All I'm saying is, when you give, when we worship the Lord through song, we worship through studying word, through discipleship, through financial contributions, getting a mission. Do you know what our real mission is here? You know, you said it. We have signs. We say loving God and loving people. But do you know, bottom line, this really is a church that we don't succeed unless we're lifting up the name of Jesus. We don't succeed unless we're telling someone that's hurting and dying and broken that they have hope and they have a choice and a chance to receive Him. Tonight, I just want to remind us everything that we do. What if every single thing we did just totally out of love for the Lord? Not to ever be compelled. I don't ever want someone to be compelled to worship because someone stands with a mic and they sound good. I don't ever want someone just to be compelled because Justin or myself or anyone else might stand up here and let you know that God has promises for you financially, so you should trust Him. That's all great, but I want our spirits to be so hungry for what God's promises are that when we sing, when we praise, remember, this is just our pit stop. This is where we get ready, and then we got some work to do outside of these doors. But tonight, I want to ask, Father, would you accept, Lord? God, there's been just a powerful presence. You've shown up in a great way already tonight. And Lord, I just pray tonight that You would receive, just in a time of giving, a time of worship, Lord, whether someone's bringing a covenant and they've set out and they have a tithe covenant they bring to You, if there's a first fruit, a seed, an offering, any sort of a contribution, if there's someone, God, that maybe they're not even joining us tonight, and they're saying, I want to partner with a church that is about the Father's business, that's about seeing souls saved and going out and meeting needs in the community. Lord, I just pray that there continue to be folks that would partner with us, that we could continue to grow the mission You put upon this family of believers. Lord, we love You tonight. I pray that every gift and every giver would just be, would receive Your strength by the power of Your Spirit, that You would be the hero in every situation. Lord, we love You, and we just simply say thank You, Father. Thank You for who You are. Thank You for what You've done. Thank You, God, for Your goodness. And we pray that You would take and receive our gifts and our offerings tonight, that it would be used for Your glory. And Father, with every decision that's made, I pray that You give us wisdom and knowledge to use every single penny of every contribution for its greatest intended purpose for Your kingdom, Father. We love You tonight. And we praise You, and we thank You for it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Waymaker tonight. You know that? He is a waymaker. When we forget and we walk away, He is still a waymaker. God, we thank You that You've made a way in our lives. Someone that even when we don't see it,
even when I don't see it, Your work
Waymaker for you. Can we give him just a little more praise tonight?
Waymaker, miracle worker.
Lord, we thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. I'll give you that back. I'm just so blessed tonight. We have some of the greatest, most wonderful young people just all over the place that show up around here. Our children's camp out weekend was such a success. We had so many children just coming and praying and receiving the Lord. Young people, teenagers. Right now, I want to dismiss. I know that there's already several over there, but if you still have not dismissed or gone to your classes tonight, we want to allow you to go. I know it's going to be an exciting evening of ministry. And I'm also, I gotta be totally honest with you. I'm pretty stoked about tonight because there's some kind of fire that I'm detecting in my brother Justin here. He showed up to church. Yeah, it might be this one. No. And I'm excited. He's been working on something to present, to share the word tonight. And how many of you appreciate the gift, what God is doing in our brother Justin? And I'm so proud. He stepped up, 3 years ago and said, I want to do more for God. And he's walked the walk. Let me tell you something. Him and his wife, Jen, and I'm not sure, maybe, I don't think they're fighting, but they're three rows apart. She's right there. I guess you're not fighting. No, I'm kidding. But I'm really proud of them. They have walked the walk. He said, Pastor Jason, I want to do more for God. What can I do? I want to get involved. I want to do this. I want to do that. And you know what? Every single time, let me tell you something that makes a pastor's job something that I just can rejoice and celebrate. Every time we've ever come to them and said, this is something that we could use help with, or this is something that we would like to present to you, that you step out and do, attempt, try, help, serve. And so many are like that, but I'm just excited tonight. Justin, I want you to just share that word with us. Can you put your hands together for this beautiful couple? I'm proud of you guys. Thank you for sharing your gift tonight.
For everyone. Can everyone hear me okay? Very good. So, tonight I have a very powerful word that I hope that the hope with the guidance and power of the Holy Spirit that He will help me to deliver it with wisdom, revelation, in clarity that all of us can understand and become more powerful than we possibly could have imagined in the days that we were in the past. Let me make sure that this bad boy is turned on here. And it looks like we have power. So, one of the nice things about a good old-fashioned Casio is, see, we call these smartwatches, and one of its greatest advantages is you don't have to use Bluetooth with it because you like your smartwatches and stuff like that, but guess what? When the Bluetooth goes out, it's about as useful as having a ice cube in the pits of the deep south. It doesn't exactly do much good then, does it? But I'm just a fan of the classics. But so the title of tonight's sermon is The Scales of God's Justice, an examination of biblical justice and social justice. I can get my computer to actually go ahead and proceed if it'll work with me here. Sometimes it doesn't always like to cooperate, but before we get into our scriptures, I would like to do a quick prayer, if that's okay. Lord Jesus, we just want to say thank you for being so awesome and how you continue to ignite that fire in our hearts and light up our hearts with your unending promises that your mercies are continually renewed each day. And God, I just thank you for where we're going and where you're going to take us. And Lord, I just pray that your word goes forth more powerfully than ever. May your light shine in this place. We just give it all to you. Be glorified through us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. So for tonight's scriptures, we have a selection of three, all from the Old Testament. But first, I'd like to turn to the book of Psalms, chapter 37, verses 27 to 29. And I'm actually going to be reading from the Christian Standard Bible version, my spiritual weapon of choice, if I may be bold. I hope that's okay if I use that lingo. But the Word of God says from here, turn away from evil, do what is good, and settle permanently, for the Lord loves justice, underscore that, loves justice, and will not abandon his faithful ones. They are kept safe forever. But the children of the wicked will be destroyed, and the righteous will inherit the land and dwell in it permanently. When we turn to the book of Amos, that's a very familiar portion of scripture that was quoted by one of my all-time favorite preachers, and none other than Martin Luther King Jr. Controversy set aside, God used him to do a mighty work in his day. But the book of Amos, chapter 5, verse 24, says the following. But let justice flow like water and righteousness like an unfailing stream. And then lastly, going back to the book of Proverbs. When we turn to the book of Proverbs in chapter 21, reading at the 15th verse. Once when I get over there, that is. There we go. Proverbs 21:15 says the following. Justice executed is a joy to the righteous, but a terror to those who practice iniquity. I'm going to be blunt because tonight we are going to be talking about a subject that can be described as very controversial, but we're going to be hitting something absolutely head on. I'd like to describe a picture for you for a split second. There was this one African-American young man who was in his teenage years. Imagine that he's walking in his neighborhood and that he's stopped by a police officer. And he gets told he matches the description of a subject who stole somebody else's book bag filled with different goods. But the thing was, he didn't do it. He was nowhere near the apparent crime scene or vice versa, but despite that, he's booked and he's taken to jail. And he said he'll be, the magistrate or the officer that was manning the prison or jail, if you will, said, well, if you can pay so much, you'll be able to make bail. But his family couldn't make bail. The next thing you know, he was locked in a prison for 3 years. But the most shocking aspect was he never had a trial and he was never convicted of a crime and all charges were dropped. What time frame and setting is it that we're describing here? Guess what? I'm not talking about 1964 Mississippi during the Summer of Freedom in the context of maybe the infamous Mississippi burning FBI case or the movie possibly by the same name, but the time and setting is from 2010 to 2013, the Bronx and Rikers Island, because the gentleman that I was talking about, his name is Caliph Browder. He spent 2 of those 3 years in solitary confinement. And because of the stress he incurred, unfortunately, he ended up taking his life in 2015, and it just tore his family apart. So as we proceed in the Word of God, I figured it's now, with the time that we're living in, it's important for us to unpack some definitions of 2 different terms that refer to justice. First, I would like to define biblical justice according to an article from Christianity Today. It's defined as a justice that makes individuals, communities, and the cosmos whole by uploading both goodness and impartiality. Social justice, according to the Oxford Dictionary, and I kind of like this peculiar definition, it states the following. The objective of creating a fair and equal society in which each individual matters, their rights are recognized and protected, and decisions are made in ways that are fair and honest. So, the question is, why are we focusing on justice? If there's one thing that can easily be answered, 2020 was one absolutely chaotic year. And 2021 hasn't been too far different, with the exception that there really hasn't been any evidence of lockdowns, unfortunately, with the Delta variant. That might be subject to change, but I'm speaking against it right now in the name of Jesus. No more lockdowns. No more lockdowns. Even though you have a cool name in Delta, you are not cool at all. COVID, go away. So over the past year and a half, over the past number of years, really, there's been an increase in discussion on matters of racial oppression and social justice. This term that has been adopted quite liberally by the American lexicon. The issues of systematic racism and oppression have taken center stage in the American national psyche, and our society, day by day, it seems, based on what we see in news reports, is being challenged to confront its past. It's been a year that's been marked by protests. And we've all seen the news reports, there's been significant killings of unarmed, usually in the realm of unarmed African Americans by police officers and other white Americans. At least that's what we see in the news. And unfortunately, it's a truth and it's a valid fact that cannot be denied. And we've seen racial tensions building up over the last several years since 2013 with very similar killings. Over the past year and a half, well, really since 2015, we've seen a significant battle ensue over flags. We have seen the rise of a very colorful assortment of flags, from the rainbow stripe flag to the American flag to the Confederate flag, the Blue Lives Matter flag, the Black Lives Matter flag, you name it. If there was something I didn't, for all we know, we might have a flag for a bathroom. Who knows? Maybe that's the next on the list. But the debate has been igniting significantly in school board meetings, in our classrooms, in our universities, in our churches, in coffee shops, in diners across America, wondering what it is that we should do about Confederate statues, what historical narrative should be spoken of in terms of the New York Times dubbed 1619 Project, or the narrative of American history that began with the Pilgrims at Plymouth, Massachusetts. there's a lot of different things going on as we engage in our discussion tonight. But there's an even more particularly ghastly issue that some of you may not have heard of, but I hope will help awaken us to what's going on. With residential schools in Canada, this is basically a system that was established in the, I believe, the late 19th century with the 1870s by one of Canada's former prime ministers that operated from that time all the way up until 1996, and their sole purpose was to split up the children of Indigenous or First Nations and families and force them to convert to Christianity and assimilate into Anglo-Saxon culture by being forced to speak English or French. They were punished significantly if they were caught speaking in their Native American language or practicing any aspect of their Native American culture. In May of 2021, there were 215 bodies of former children that were discovered at a site near the Kamloops Indian Residential School in British Columbia, according to the BBC. Over the past number of months, that number has since skyrocketed to over 1,000, with that number only expected to grow based at the various sites of residential schools. In Saskatchewan, the remains of as many as 751 children have been found at another residential school, according to the New York Times. But what's the significance of all this? So I've talked about some of these points already, but the fact that in supposed Christian institutions that these children were brutalized and attacked, and the now horrific discoveries that we're just finding with these remains being discovered, and I believe they were discovered with ground-penetrating radar. Some of the children were as young as 3 years old, because Billy Graham once said that the strongest Christians are those who have a Bible in one hand and a newspaper in the other. But nowadays, it's a smartphone or a tablet device. But either way, you get the principle. It makes sense. It's all according to the same thing. So the information that I cited, of course, was mostly from the BBC. But we must answer the question, does the United States arguably have a racist past and present? I would say historical evidence, unfortunately, suggests so. Exhibit A, the former concept known as manifest destiny. It was a 19th century expansionist ideology that basically held that America's continental expansion was inevitable and justifiable because, in their minds, America was a chosen nation from God in order to spread the blessings of republican democracy across the world. American exceptionalism held that the United States was to spread the blessings of God through the advent of our style of government. There was an individual by the name of John L. O'Sullivan that you see pictured there. Rather interesting fashion sense with that bow tie. I know my wife likes bow ties, but I wasn't so much for bow ties, unless if I could get one of those that could make it flip around and whatever, and I would be able to fly like Inspector Gadget or something. But I have an excerpt here from an article called The Great Nation of Futurity in the 1839 edition of the United States Democratic Review, which says, "The far-reaching, the boundless future will be the era of American greatness." And I want you to hear the nationalism language here. That extreme form of love of country and that it's superior to everybody else no matter what. It's in its magnificent domain of space and time, the nation of many nations is destined to manifest to mankind the excellence of divine principles, to establish on earth the noblest temple ever dedicated to the worship of the Most High. Last I saw, that was for Israel when he comes back. The sacred and the true. Its floor shall be a hemisphere, its roof the firmament of the star-studded heavens, and its congregation and union of many republics, comprising hundreds of happy millions, calling, owning no man, master, but governed by God's natural and moral law of equality, the law of brotherhood, of peace and goodwill amongst men. But as we can see from historical example, unfortunately, that didn't extend to everyone. The first example that we have, of course, is the most glaringly obvious, the civil rights movement and the struggle against Jim Crow. Whether if it was seen, the news reports, or the TV segments on the evening news where African Americans and other protesters who joined in the movement were being blasted by the fire hose and being attacked by guard dogs and beaten to death by police and troops, this is a definitively glaring example. Not to mention the Trail of Tears and the brutal treatment of the Native Americans. The Trail of Tears saga was roughly around the 1830s to the 1840s, but President Andrew Jackson passed the Indian Removal Act with the assistance of Congress that forced 100,000, give or take, Native Americans, primarily Cherokee, to vacate or surrender their land to march in excess of 5,000 miles west. The Trail of Tears was obviously given its name for the collective suffering of those who were forced to march, according to the Encyclopedia Britannica. And then we have anti-Semitism and Holocaust denial stretching into the present. And we also have, unfortunately, ugly, grotesque stereotypes surrounding the Hispanic community and countless others. But these are just a few of the examples that I could just pull from. But I would like to delve into what the Church of God actually has to say on it, because I found something rather interesting. According to the Church of God's website, under its practical commitments in regard to social obligation, it says the following, and this is our denomination, by the way. Love for others and the recognition of the equal worth of all men in the sight of God, according to Acts chapter 10, verse 34, and Acts 17, 26, should compel us to take steps to improve the situation of those who are underprivileged, neglected, hungry, homeless, and victimized by prejudice, persecution, and oppression. And it lists the scriptures there as well, such as Matthew 22, 39, and 1 John 3, 17. In all of our dealings, we must be sensitive to human needs. James 1:27 emphasizes that point, along with my wife's favorite gospel writer, the good doctor, Luke, according to the 10th chapter, verses 30 to 37. And we must guard against racial and economic discrimination. Every person should have freedom to worship and participate in the life of the church, regardless of race, color, sex, social class, or nationality without question. So I wanted to dive into some really cool examples of justice in the Old Testament, of those in the Old Testament who stood for justice as God called them to do. Of course, our most obvious example is Moses leading the Israelites from oppression under the yoke of Egyptian slavery with the parting of the Red Sea. But I would like to bring attention to some others, if I may. Isaiah, the fifth gospel writer, jokingly called because he has the highest element of Christology, as we Bible nerds like to call it, as in describing the coming of the Messiah with various prophecies and so forth. In chapter 1, verse 17, Isaiah calls for all believers to seek justice and condemn and oppose oppression. We are also called to bring justice to the fatherless and plead the cause of the widow or those who can't provide for themselves. So we see this example all throughout the Old Testament. The weeping prophet, the prophet Jeremiah. In the book of Jeremiah 22, verse 3, we're called to deliver those who have been robbed from the hands of their oppressors. And we're also called to justice and righteousness as disciples of Christ to stand up for those who have been afflicted. One of my personal favorites, of course, if you haven't figured it out yet, the prophet Amos. I'm always a sucker for stained glass. That picture was really cool. I just wanted to mix it all up with stained glass. I have ties with stained glass on it. I can't get enough of this stuff. And of course, in Amos 5:24 that we quoted earlier, Amos, I believe, was a farmer according to historical tradition, and he makes an emphatic proclamation for the justice of God to pour down and be implemented. He talks about how Israel was experiencing a false sense of prosperity because of exploitation and corruption. And Amos was commissioned by God to call out the rampant corruption and sin of his day. And in the Proverbs and the Psalms, in Psalms 82:3, it says to provide justice for the needy and the fatherless, uphold the rights of the oppressed and the destitute. Proverbs 31:9, speak up, judge righteously, and defend the cause of the oppressed and needy. That is absolutely one of the biggest reasons why I love our outreach ministry, because we are putting these principles into action, and souls are being saved, and souls are being changed. I can't emphasize it enough, because last time we were out there, one soul gave her life to Christ, and we were able to pray for another brother for a renewed commitment and for hopefully that, of course, the Lord's going to provide for his every need. And we're believing that we're going to hear a marvelous testimony if we run into him the next time. But now I'd like to address examples of justice in the New Testament. I wish I would have brought my gavel, because, I mean, with this wooden podium, I always just like banging it on purpose to annoy the tar out of people. But then my wife would say, "You're sleeping on the couch." But no, that ain't true. But one of my all-time favorite New Testament writers, the book of James, the man of practical faith in the New Testament book of Proverbs, he calls us not to discriminate against other disciples. He also called out wealthy believers for their blatant overindulgence. We see it all throughout his writings. And the audience of the epistle and believers of all times were called to be doers of the word. And then we have the original apostles in general, and of course the Apostle Paul. Yeah, I'm looking right at you, the Apostle Paul. Peter ministered to the house of Cornelius and other Gentiles in Acts chapter 10. The sick were being healed by the apostles with no cost whatsoever, according to Acts chapter 5, and the church also provided for the needs of others as the occurrence came in Acts chapter 4. So, of course, we have our ultimate justice advocate in Jesus Christ, of course. There are so many examples that we can pull from, but I would like to begin by pulling another writing from the good doctor's writing from the book of Luke chapter 4, verses 17 to 21, which says the following. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. Unrolling the scroll, he found the place where it was written, and he's quoting from Isaiah here. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. He then rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down, and the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fixed on him. He began by saying to them, and I emphasize the red ink, "Today, as you listen, this scripture has been fulfilled." Right off the bat, Jesus Christ and only him alone is the ultimate fulfillment of all things that correlate with justice that we know and comprehend. Jesus stood against racial oppression in his day. He ministered to the Samaritan woman, and a Samaritan was regarded as the hero of the infamous parable that has been dubbed by the same name, the parable of the Good Samaritan. And Jesus healed Gentiles such as the daughter of the Roman centurion and countless others. And as a matter of fact, the Roman centurion understood authority. He said, "By your word only." And he said to the Gentile, "Never before have I seen so great a faith than in the house of Israel." Continuing on, thank goodness for Creative Commons, by the way. I was actually able to get a good selection of photos, and I try to get Jesus to be depicted accurately as some anthropologists would have painted him, like as a Middle Eastern of Hebrew descent and vice versa, of course, for obvious reasons. So If you could get offended by he's not the white guy Jesus, sorry guys, but you know this is who we're going to arguably be looking at in the kingdom of heaven. But anyway, he fed the multitudes and it cost nobody anything. What's even more remarkable is that there was a story of the little boy with the meager provisions of the fish and a couple of loaves of bread that he had. And Jesus broke it and blessed it, and he was able to feed multitudes. And then, as we get ready to, this is awesome. I will never be ashamed to talk about Christ who's coming back as a victorious and conquering king. There's so many things that could be spoken about in the beauty of this picture, but how much more beautiful is our coming and conquering king going to be when he comes back and the trumpet sounds? The ultimate justice is not going to be found in this world, but we are clearly called to be doers of the word and standing up against racial oppression and various examples of racism that we can arguably see in our society today. But you know, and I was thinking a lot about my own past on Sunday. You see, Sunday was the last day of our Get S'more of Jesus Vacation Bible School end of summer camp out. And as I saw the joy on the kids' faces, it really made me think about where I came from. And for some reason, I told my wife, it only kind of made me the more upset when I thought about my own past because I felt like my childhood was robbed from me because of the circumstances that I was in. I came from a house that unfortunately, you know, my mom and dad, they weren't saints by any means, and none of us are. But I came from a house, unfortunately, that was filled with marijuana and different drugs, but God shielded me in his grace from all of that. And I'm thankful that he kept me from that. But because of the type of family that I came from, I didn't have a normal childhood, and I thought it was completely robbed from me, that I was gypped, that I had lost everything. I wasn't raised in the church to be able to have a Sunday school program or a vacation Bible school program of that sort. But it made me think of a very beautiful scripture that's really not quoted much, and it needs to be. You see, the ultimate manifestation of God's justice is the redemption, the fulfillment of all history, the consummation, the great wedding. You see, I want every last one of you, including myself, to think about the most brutal of circumstances that you have ever been in. The most egregious injustice that somebody has ever done to you. The harshest treatment. Whether if it be in the form of somebody stabbing you in the back by not paying you back when they said that they would, or if somebody broke into your house and robbed you of your most prized possessions. Imagine if you had a job where you had to talk to people on the phone all day long and you just felt like they just yelled at you, talked down to you, and just basically ripped you a new one from day one all the way to the present of the week or whatever the case may be. Imagine being criticized, being made fun of. Imagine absolutely every possible grotesque and evil negative thing. And imagine that God is going to repay you even more. What does that look like? I brought up my example because in the book of Joel, chapter 2, verse 25, it says, I will repay you for the years that the swarming locust ate. The young locust, the destroying locust, and the devouring locust, my great army that I sent against you. In Galatians 3:28 says it all. We are all one in Christ no matter what. It doesn't matter what skin color you are. It doesn't matter what economic status that you have. It doesn't matter what circumstances you came from. The gospel of Jesus Christ and his church are without question for everybody, because anybody who has ever been victimized by evil in this world, the one thing that is so under-talked about or not discussed enough is the justice of God. We talk about the love of God, but a lot of times in the Bible, you will find the words love and justice going hand in hand in the same sentence. To anybody who has suffered from evil in some form in this world, I don't know what it is that you may have gone through, but I'm sorry that you had to go through that. But the entire book of Revelation was written to remind Christians that pretty soon, very soon, that Jesus is coming back, and it's not going to matter what people told you in terms of words of death. No matter if it was on the job, no matter if it was a close personal friend that you knew and they just completely randomly ghosted you and turned their backs on you. It doesn't matter if somebody beat you up or if somebody just tore you a new one on Facebook, or if somebody robbed you. God is going to repay not only everything that we lost, but he is going to make it more beautiful than ever, because we are going to be among the numberless multitudes where they're from every tribe and every nation and every tongue. It doesn't matter what happened yesterday, because this says the only thing that matters is the future. Our God is a God of love, absolutely, but even more than that, our God is a God of justice, and he will repay what you have lost, and he will give you more on top of that. The greatest feast, the greatest thing that we are going to experience is the wedding supper of the Lamb, which is why I had Grandpa at my wedding, at our wedding, read Revelation chapter 19, verses 6 to 9. I encourage you all, please read it, because that's what we are going to be partaking of. Soon, racism is going to be eradicated in this world. Soon, justice will be established in the fullest possible sense, because when the trumpet sounds, evil is dead. As a matter of fact, evil's already defeated. I want you to imagine your favorite sport, whether it be football, baseball, soccer, handball, whatever the case is. For me, it's chess. For me, the devil is checkmated. For football, you just scored the game-winning touchdown, and the devil's, as a matter of fact, not just that, it was a massive blowout as far as Jesus Christ is concerned. You've scored every possible goal in that soccer game. You've hit every possible grand slam in that baseball game. But the crazy thing is, the reward that's coming for us is even greater than what I just described. Any wealth on this planet that you can possibly conceive, whether it be Bill Gates or what, fill in the blank with whatever billionaire you want to think of, Donald Trump, Vince McMahon, whatever, the wealth of Christ is always greater. And we're going to be co-heirs with him with the greatest distinction of power that any individual next to Christ could possibly ever have. As co-heirs in Christ, we are made partakers of the royal priesthood, kings and queens and priests combined into one. No other person in history could take that title except Christ and his infinite grace, and with the reward that he's going to have coming with him when he says he's coming quickly. We will get our due. He will bring his justice. Whatever happened to us in terms of evil, he will turn it back for good. Guys, the time is drawing nigh where time is running out. So the question is, I'd like to issue a challenge to the church to step out of your comfort zone. If you haven't partaken of the outreach ministry, I am challenging you all right now. If you've already engaging in it, step out of your comfort zone like Brother John did that first time that we went. He was uncomfortable with evangelizing, and Brother John, we know you're probably on your way to Colorado probably today or tomorrow, but we miss you, brother. You are an awesome brother in Christ, and thank you for letting God use you the way that you have to bless us. If you haven't partaken of the outreach ministry, just as an example, step out of your comfort zone and come with a heart that's going to expect the unexpected, because the wealth that you will feel in terms of spiritual treasure in your heart cannot be matched. If you have always wondered about the possibility of engaging in the kids ministry, have an open heart and tell Pastor Jason or Pastor Melissa, you know what? I think the time has come for me to step out of my comfort zone and engage in the kids ministry. Or if you have a heart for cleaning the church, step up and say, you know what? How can I help clean the church? You know, I'm available so many days. Or if it's just having a conversation with somebody at a restaurant that you frequent at, maybe a waitress or a manager or vice versa, that you've gotten to know on a personal level, and just tell them about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Whatever God challenges you to do, embrace that to the fullest, because the Lord is guaranteed to bless it. As a matter of fact, you know, Jeremy, your wife Savannah was talking about how she was so nervous about leading worship tonight. Well, guess what? She stepped out of her comfort zone, and who's thankful for Savannah and the worship team? She did a magnificent job, didn't she? The church with the greatest strength is not only the church that is grounded in the Word and that become doers of the Word, but the church with the greatest strength are those members or assemblies that are constantly challenged and stretched out to step out of their comfort zone each and every day to ascend to a higher level of faith. So in this hour, I encourage you, the cards are on the table, but what are you going to do with them? Are you going to just step out and say, you fold them? Or are you going to go for the jackpot? Not that I'm condoning gambling or anything like that, but it's a good example. Are we going to pick up our ball and go home? Or are we going to try to shoot the game-winning shot? Because guess what? Even if what you feel God leading you to do might end up as a failure, guess what? All of us have experienced that in some form or another. But the Lord is still happy that you were obedient to his call. Because we can't do anything, but the Word always says, he brings the increase. All you got to do is challenge yourself and step out of your comfort zone, and the Lord in his glory will do the rest. That's all that I had on my heart today. I know it was probably a little bit more of a more controversial topic, but the issue of racism, unfortunately, is still alive and well in various capacities, whether if it may be in some aspects of our criminal justice system, even unfortunately still to this day in some churches. Thank goodness, not in ours, but there's a few of them that I always constantly hear about. I'm sick and tired of seeing images of unarmed African Americans, unfortunately, being killed by whoever the party may be that's responsible. I'm sick and tired of people within our own church being victimized by somebody breaking into their house and robbing them, or being victimized by words of death. Maybe even to some degree, sometimes people can speak words of death about other members right within their own church. People are being raised up here. People are being used for God's glory here. Let me tell you something. You're getting ready to be part of one of the greatest things that Cumberland has today. Do you want to be a part of it, or do you want to just tear it down with your gossip and slander and words of death? I, for one, want to be a part of it. And when I was a kid in school, I was always called the leader of the pack. I always wanted to be the first to do something, to make a difference. Guys, I want to help lead us with Pastor Jason and with the glory of God, with the Holy Spirit's power and anointing to step out into a new phase of ministry to make the fires of revival even bigger than what they were in 2019. It doesn't matter what 2020 held, but 2019, we were saying that our church was on fire. Well, guess what? Let that fire engulf into a whole heaping help of fire that we can't even possibly contain. Who's with me? Glorify God. Thank you. God gets all the glory alone for it. It doesn't matter what your past holds, because the glory of God is getting ready to come in your life more powerful than ever, especially when we be doers of His word. Lord Jesus, we just want to say thank you so much for this day, and thank you for this time that we can spend together. And God, I just thank you for this word and for this amazing body of believers. I thank you for our Pastor Jason, Pastor Melissa, and his family, and how you've blessed us with them. We thank you, Lord, for how you use Brother John to encourage us and just get us back to the basics of faith, because sometimes that needs to happen for us to grow, Lord. And God, I just pray that you anoint every single believer here today. And Lord, actually, if I may, I'm extending my hand to commission every single body of believers in this assembly and even on Facebook or social media or YouTube on Thursday night. God, I just pray that you commission these individuals. I commission them in your name, Lord, to be used for your glory, to fulfill the great commission before the trumpet sounds, where your table will be filled with souls, Lord. It doesn't matter whether we fill a sanctuary. It doesn't matter anything like that, Lord, but it matters how many souls that we win, that you use us to win for your kingdom, Lord. Bless every family with a financial miracle and outpouring to become even greater blessings to your people, Lord. Help us to be people of integrity, to walk and fulfill every ounce of your word as much as possible, Lord. Help us to be that one church, if we may be the only one standing left, that people look at and say, you know what, that's a lighthouse in the darkness. I want to go to that church because things are happening at that church. The Spirit of God is on the move at that church. Spirit of God, you are welcome here. Overflow us. Fill us with every ounce of your anointing, Lord. And may your justice and grace and peace and love be filled in this people here today. Help us to be extensions of your love and justice in this hour, Lord, more powerfully than ever. We give it all to you, Lord, in Jesus' matchless name. Amen.
Did you guys learn something new today? Mission accomplished.
Amen. I don't know if you've ever been out to eat and someone looked like they were enjoying what they had and you said, I want what they're having. I want what Justin had tonight. I appreciate that kind of passion, because I'm telling you, you know, you make a difference. People will live and die because of the passion of their heart. And I'm excited. I believe that where it is our time to be, we sang about it. I didn't really know that the Spirit had me saying some things. I didn't know what you were going to be really talking about, but we are being called to be doers. Doers. Just little old you and me. Doers to change all of eternity for somebody. And I'm excited because God's choosing us. He's choosing us. I'm not going to back away from His call. The time is too short. Our time is now. And I do want to say, we have to continue to see and celebrate and unselfishly want to accelerate one another. Because this is a place where if you have a gift and a talent and you allow it to be used, it will be. I've been in churches where someone says, you know, 20 years later, no one ever allowed me to do this and this and this. That's not going to happen here. If you're not doing it, it's because you're choosing not to. We're not intimidated by the gifts of the body of Christ. We celebrate them here. We want to see them raised up and multiplied for God's glory, because that's how we're going to change our community. by recognizing and supporting. Powerful tonight, Justin. Thank you for bringing that. And you know what I love? Guess what? Some of us don't have the boldness to talk about racism because we don't know how to talk about it, because some of y'all still struggle with it. You judge people by their skin color or how they look. You call them names and you think, well, it's just a joke. That's how I was brought up. No, that's part of the problem. Jesus died for Anglo-Saxon Jason. Jesus died for African-American Jason. Jesus died for Mexican Jason. Jesus died for British Jason. Jesus died for country hick you. Jesus died for walking New York streets you. For millionaire billionaire you. And he died for the one that's homeless you. Like, I'm excited because I feel like we're getting a glimpse of that. And that's the differences we're going to make, because I'm thinking too, when's the next time we put a challenge out there, but what's the specifics? When is the next time people can get involved with our outreach? The 28th, next Saturday. Okay, so whatever Saturday you want to call that, it is the 28th. And is that going to be at 2 o'clock? And ready to go. And we have plans to just get uncomfortable, expand our territory, and go beyond what you think you can do. God can use you if you're willing. God can use you if you're willing. And I was sitting there thinking tonight, and I don't think this is an exaggeration, since we have been back here in Cumberland, September will be 3 years, I can't think of not one time in 3 years that the Spirit of God inspired me to go speak to someone that it did not end with something extremely powerful, a miracle, or a salvation. And it was every time I allowed the Spirit to lead me and I stepped out. See, whether I'm Pastor Jason, music minister Jason, youth pastor Jason, bathroom cleaner Jason, no matter what I am, I'm a soul winner because that's what God's put in my heart. I like to see people be changed. I like to see people like a family like yours come to Christ, and then invite another family like yours to come to Christ, and then a young lady who had no direction stand up and lead us into the presence of God. It wasn't happening 2 years ago. I like to see people like Brother John Garner, a man that was hurt and beaten and broken and bruised verbally by people in the community and going through a wilderness, take his gift and begin to use it. I told him this last time I saw him, I said, "Brother, you're the exact example of what God does here in our ministry. He takes brokenness, he finds value in it, he polishes it, and he sends it out to be used." And I see it in you. I'm looking. There's not one of you that there's not something I know for a fact so valuable and special in us. And that word tonight, that, you know what? Yeah, there's big issues. Yeah, there's big problems. But you know what? We're called to be part of the solution. And go ahead, grab that mic. I'm just telling you, we're called to be doers. And I'm excited. I'm excited because we're going to do. We're going to continue to do.
We all know that racism in all forms is absolutely evil and detestable because Christ died for every single last one of us. But I just wanted to make sure that I was clear on why I brought up my past in the reference to last Sunday. The manner that God restored my lost years was when I actually got to join the coolest children's ministry team in the world in being able to help kids, to help show kids a childhood that I'd never got to experience. God truly does restore our lost years, and God restored that to me by being able to partake of such a vibrant children's ministry. Coolest feeling ever.
He'll restore, and he'll pay back, and it's exciting. The 21st. Okay, Saturday, the 21st, 2 o'clock. It might be 21st and 28th, depends on what the Lord does. No, but I'm just excited tonight. Take this word and this challenge tonight and walk out of here different. I was telling someone this week, I said, I am so thankful And I hope this makes sense. I think some of you will understand this. Don't get confused by this. I'm extremely thankful and content with God, what God's doing in me and giving me, but I'm so discontent because I know that there's so much more. And I want to be all that I'm called to be. That's just me telling you. I am discontent with where I am at. I want more of God. It's not a selfish thing, but I know that he said, draw near to me and I'll draw near to you. So I know that he promises more. I'm just curious, do you want more of God? And we say yes, but then 5 years from now, we sit exactly like we sit tonight. And it's not God's fault. If we want more of him, he says, step close to me and watch what I do. I'll get right there with you. I'll give you all that you desire. I'll give you the strength. I'll give you the ability. I'll raise you up to sing when you think you can. I'll raise you up to witness when you think you're not available or equipped. And I'll raise you up. Everything that you've been through is for a reason. I'm starting to appreciate the hard times more than I ever have in my life. Every single thing. And what a great testimony on that. Y'all, you almost started pulling my emotions. I was getting ready to stand there and shed a tear on that one because, do you know what? He could have been a statistic. Justin could have been a statistic of a kid who got forgotten about, pushed to the side, made fun of, called certain things, put on the back burner. And he didn't get all that, but you know what God did? He took some of the deepest, I can guarantee, probably even as you're in your adult life, some of the deepest hurts came from what did and didn't happen in your childhood. And God has taken and he is like a surgical perfection and brought that. And now one of the greatest things, you know how powerful him and his wife were with our children's ministry the last couple nights this weekend? We could be upset and jealous and angry with God and say, well, God, you never did that for me, so I'm not going to be a part of nothing like that. I was robbed, so I'm not giving. That's not how it is. Sometimes your greatest seed has to be sown in your greatest hurt. Sometimes your biggest investment has to be sown in the middle of what doesn't even make sense. And I just want to challenge you that are here tonight, it is on purpose. You're here for a reason, and I want to... That word inspired me, but I want to challenge you. Let's make a difference. And now that challenges me after this word to make sure that I'm not looking just in one place to witness, that I'm looking to sow my seed everywhere, even where I think it could land on hard soil, even where I think it could land on a hard concrete sidewalk. Even where I think it could be overtaken. But that's something. I'll just be honest as a pastor. Even without intention, we can have racism in a church if we only want to win certain kinds of people. When's the last time we walked into the midst of folks that make us extremely uncomfortable and we started saying, his blood is enough for you as well. What he did on the cross is for you. And I challenge us all with that. You got me stirred up. I want what he's having. No, I'm just excited in there, and I think Jen's probably the source of his spark. You better get that water. No, but I'm excited tonight. I know that this Sunday is going to be a really, and I know I say this a lot, but I'm telling you, like, the wilderness, you got to get here. Invite somebody. Get them here, because if we can get some hurting and lost and broken people in the building, they're going to get to hear what Christ's intention is with our hard times and the changes he can make. Help me get some more folks in here to hear the message. Sunday's going to be powerful. I know we're in revival. You should look at, don't change the look on your face for a minute. Y'all just keep staring me down just like that. Turn around and look at these people that are in revival. Do they look like they're in revival? Or do they look like they're tired and wore out and staring me down like, what are you even saying? I'm picking on y'all. Praise the Lord that what he does in our spirit has nothing to do with what our face looks like. Because, dear God, if the Lord had to wait and move once we all looked full of the Spirit... I just glanced for a minute. I was like, man, y'all are angry tonight. But I'm sorry. Oh, God is just so good. I just be blessed. And you know, I didn't mean to take 5-10 extra minutes when we were giving. I hope you understand. I really hope you understand. God's intention is to bless every area of your life. And you don't have to wonder, well, what's his intentions? What's his motives? He wants to talk about money. Yes, I do. Because God desires to bless your money. Just like he wants to bless your spirit. And he wants to correct your addictions. And he wants to set you free from anger issues. And he wants to break you free from the mountains that you think you have to climb. And he says, come on, trust me. And they're just steps. It's just going to take you to where you need to be. Do you love the Lord tonight? I know when it came down to Peter, and he was trying to run and go back to his stuff, you know what Peter did? Went fishing again. I just keep thinking about Christ's question to him. He didn't ask him anything except, do you love me? And I pray tonight that you can walk out of here having a confident answer when Christ says, do you love me? Never. You know, what was the Sunday when, I think it's been about 2 weeks ago, I stood up here and I thought, God, we have so much stuff planned, so many things we need to talk about, so many things that were even supposed to happen after service. And the Lord was, said, no, there's some people that need to be set free from their battle. And the Spirit of God started touching people's lives. And you know what's funny? Because as he was moving in a great and a mighty way, do you know who was also moving? Do you know who was also getting ready to raise their voice? You know who was also getting ready to come against the church? The enemy. And after that service, we had 2 weeks of attack on families all over this ministry. After the Lord said, I am here to take your battle from you. It was 2 weeks of some of the biggest battles I've seen here since I've been here in 3 years. People, all sorts. And it's no one's individual failures or faults. It's the enemy saying, you want to think you're going to let the Spirit of God move, huh? You want to make a difference in your community, do you? I said it a couple weeks ago, almost like that middle school shoulder bump. Oh, you want to get into the presence of God, do you? Bam, I'll throw this battle your way. What are you going to do now, Christian? We can't apologize. And a couple people have said to me, and I have to change the vocabulary sometimes it comes out of my mouth because I'm never sorry for obeying the Spirit. That's why I'm here. And I would rather shut the church down than just live out a schedule. Like, seriously, I really would, because we're doing more harm if we try to live and work and operate based upon a person's plan. That's why sometimes when we have good plans, things still change. And y'all might say, hey, the 21st at 2 o'clock, and get out there, and the Spirit of God does something different. And I hear on the news, there's some kind of revival fire happening down by some sort of park. There's this group of people. People are just crying and singing and being prayed for. And wait a second, it wasn't supposed to be till 2 o'clock. It's like 11 a.m. What happened? God can do anything. I'm just curious. Do you really believe that we can be something great for God and in his kingdom, and that we can really fulfill the commission that's been handed to us? Do you think we can? Do you think this... I mean, what if it's just this group tonight? Do you think we can do that?
I believe it. God's done more with smaller numbers.
I believe it. Something I want to do, our Wednesday nights, I want you to get ready, because I don't know if everyone here does, but I believe that a big majority of the ministry and the family here really want to grow and be better in God. And a lot of churches, they call positions and things that they do. And I had this discussion this week, and they call people leaders. You're a leader of that. You're a leader of this. You're the leader of that. And I just, this week, I'm like, God, have we confused and perverted the church because we call the tools in your hand, the leaders? Maybe if we could begin to call people the servants of the church, we could have a better comprehension of really what's going on. Become a great servant here at Gateway West. Become the greatest servant you can at Gateway West, and watch how we'll change the community. You know, some people are out, I just want to be valuable and be looked at as a leader. That's not what I want. I want us to be looked and recognized as great servants. To just serve one another, serve the Lord, serve the community, to lift them up. Yeah. Hey, if you're joining us online, I don't know if that's already stopped or not, because all the extra conversation, they can't even hear it. We love you guys, and we're going to see you Sunday. Please join us Sunday at 10 a.m., but we're having some private family discussion here, and you can't even hear it because it's not in the mic. So we love you. Can we put our hands together for those that are checking out from our broadcast? We love you all, but go ahead.